Welcome to a special presentation by Visual Stress Canada.
We are here with a special guest from the University of Essex in the United Kingdom. Dr. Arnold Wilkins is here with us. He's with the Department of Psychology, where he is the head of the Visual Perception Unit. And his area of study is in visual stress and pattern sensitivity and how color can be used to help alleviate the symptoms of visual stress. Thank you very much for coming, Dr. Wilkins. It's very nice to have you here with us.
Thank you.
So what brings you to Canada?
Well, I'm visiting somebody at the National Research Council who's interested in lighting.
Lighting and flicker, I think.
That's right.
Okay.
LED flicker. The new lighting that's coming in is going to have a lot of flicker associated with it, and we're trying to control that appropriately.
I'm very thankful that you are here, because it's very important, the research that you've been doing on visual stress, and I'm hoping that we can increase the awareness of that here in Canada.
That would be nice, yes.
So Dr. Wilkins, tell me what first got you interested in color as a therapy for these conditions you were investigating.
The front page of the Sunday Times, where there was a report of the work by Helen Erlen and others. I'd been studying photosensitive epilepsy, and I'd found that the visual stimuli that provoke epilepsy also provoke discomfort in others. And I wondered if there was a connection, and it's turned out that there does seem to be.
And there's a connection, certainly not just with epilepsy, but in a lot of other conditions.
Yes, a wide range of neurological conditions, all of which seem to involve a hyperexcitability of the visual part of the brain. The neurons seem to be a little bit more excitable. These conditions include things like autism, migraine, and multiple sclerosis, Tourette's. There's a wide range of neurological conditions that involve problems with vision, and these problems sometimes seem to remit with colored filters.
And the term visual stress, how did that term come about?
I wrote a book called Visual Stress, in which I described the similarity between the visual stimuli that provoke seizures and those that provoke discomfort in people without epilepsy, and in which I reported initial studies we'd done with colored lenses and the intuitive calorimeter.
What was it that caused you to develop the intuitive calorimeter?
The intuitive calorimeter is a rather grand name for a box that illuminates text with coloured light. In the subtlety of it, if there is one, is that you can change the hue and the saturation independently without changing the brightness. So that allows you to gain control over the intuitive dimensions of colour and find a colour that improves the clarity of text. And that's why it's called the intuitive colorimeter.
I myself have a Mach 3 device, which thankfully you have calibrated for me. And what I found interesting is that we tested my son a week ago, and then we tested him again today, and he came out with virtually the same number. Not only the depth of color, the color itself, it was really quite interesting to see how very close he came, within one point of what was tested last week. Is that a common?
When it occurs, and some people can be extremely precise and consistent in the color they choose. And when they are, it's an indication that they are likely to benefit from the color.
Okay.
And it's an easy way of assessing the consistency, because people adapt to the color that they're exposed to, and they're unaware to a large extent of the particular hue and saturation, and that allows you to investigate the effects of the color without their being aware of the color. And it was that actually that allowed us to do a double masked study.
Good, I was going to ask you about those studies and
yes.
How many people and the science of the study.
Well, it was fairly straightforward. These studies take a long time to do, and we've done two so far, one in children with reading difficulties, another one in adults with migraine. And we selected two colours, one that matched the colour that they'd chosen in the colorimeter without their being aware that that was a match, and another one that was slightly different. Had the same sort of colour name, but not quite the same shade of colour. And with the colour that matched their setting, their symptoms improved, but not with the one that didn't. And they were given both, and one after the other, in a random order without anyone knowing which was which.
Good, so that's what they called
a double masked study.
Okay,
yes.
Okay, good. That's good, because those results are something we can take forward to the educational psychologists and the optometrists to show that a large enough population has been studied, and they've been studied without the option, opportunity to actually know the color they're looking at and have a favorite, but actually pick one that works to reduce their symptoms.
Yes, and now we're getting harder data in terms of neuroimaging. We've found that there's an abnormal oxygenation of the brain in people with migraine, and that this can be reduced with coloured filters, provided they have the correct, precise colour. Interestingly, filters that have a similar colour, which is not the one that the individual chooses for maximum comfort, have no effect at all. That's really exciting. There are two studies now that we've done, one using fMRI bold, which is the normal imaging, and also one using a new technique called near-infrared spectroscopy. Both studies show the same thing, that the brain response to aggressive visual stimuli is normalized with the right tint.
That's good. That's excellent.
Well, it's going to convince a few more people, I think.
Good, I hope so.
And it provides us a clue as to the possible neurological mechanisms underlying this curious condition. I mean, it is extraordinary to think that a coloured filter can have the effect it does, and even more extraordinary that it has to be a particular colour and one that's individually tailored. Both of these were very difficult to believe when the technique was first discovered.
How many intuitive colorimeters are there in use now in the United Kingdom?
In the United Kingdom? I'm not sure of the exact number. It's about 500, I think.
That's quite a few.
Hmm.
And is it something that they've had for several years, or is it getting more popular?
It's getting more popular. It's been there. We started with the Mark I colorimeter in 1993, I think it was. And so we've gradually been getting more and more common.
I understand it's in universities as well?
That's
the
right.
Vision institutes?
All the optometry schools have one.
Tell me about the rate of reading test and how it indicates whether or not improvement can be seen through the use of color.
Okay. The rate of reading test consists of a paragraph of text where each line has the same 15 common words that are known to kindergarten children in a different random order. And the child is asked to read the words aloud as fast as they can. So they have to see the words in order to read them. They can't guess from the context because there isn't any. And so this test seems to be very sensitive to the effects of, for example, the size of the text, or, for example, binocular problems, and also sensitive to the effects of colour. And we find that about 5% of children read about 25% faster with the colour of their chosen overlay.
My look is cat. Not look up is cat, not my and dog for you too. The cat up dog and is.
That sounds hard to believe, but it isn't, because I have actually witnessed children going from not knowing where to start on the page to reading fluidly. And the difference is quite amazing. Not in obviously everybody, every child, some at 25% and some much higher. And it's great to have the option of color to help these children read.
Absolutely. Yes, the results are occasionally almost miraculous. But I'm just quoting you the average figures.
Yes, yes. And that's a good indicator.
Mm.
All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Wilkins, for being with us here today. I appreciate the time you've taken to help us out here in Ottawa with our initiative. And thank you.
Thank you very much. Delighted to be here.
For more information, please visit our website at visualstress.ca. Thank you.